Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to be back. Thank you. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He lives.
He lives indeed.
Hallelujah. This morning, as you can see, we'll begin our service after our initial start here with the birthday hat and the peace with the baptism of our little gal, Kay, or Larkin Kay. Right? So she'll be brought into our church through the gift of baptism this morning. And then if you would look there at the back of your worship folder, you see a lot of announcements coming up. One has to do with the Mother's Day brunch. Take a look at that. There's several sign-up sheets for that. Also for readers on First Sunday, which Sunday you would like to read the Old Testament epistle. And then this Saturday at 9 o'clock, we have Adopt a Highway. And then around that time, we have LWML. Okay, so we got that going this Saturday. And there's other things chosen that we have on Tuesday, Bible study on Wednesday at 1, and everything else. Please take a look at this, okay, and take a look at it, follow it on the monitors. But please don't read it during the message, because that would be what?
Rude.
I got that from my buddy last week when he said that. So, VBS planning too, next Sunday after service. Okay, we'll be talking about our VBS. So anything else that didn't make it into the bulletin? Yes?
I'd like the people to take their lily lilies home if they would, please.
Yes, anyone who signed up for a lily that would like a lily or two, or whatever, they're here and they're in the back. Please take them, or otherwise, they're going somewhere else. Maybe at your doorstep. So, anything else? Yes?
There's also VBS sign-up sheets posted, because okay. Some people like to get their spot early.
Okay, so VBS sign-up sheet too, for those of you like to get up there early and post what you want to do for the children in our church. Anything else? Then is our custom. Oh, if you are a guest this morning, we have a book there in the back. If you would sign your name and address, we have a record. Or there's a card there in your pew. If you would, if you put it just into our offering plates, that would be great as you leave. So we have a record of your visit with us this morning. So then as our custom is, we like to celebrate birthdays. Okay, at least I did, and now our Savior, I think most of you are starting to enjoy this. Does anyone have a birth? Uh-oh, your pay point is who? I need a name. Rachel, which I knew, but by the way. So Rachel, when is your birthday?
A few weeks ago.
Oh, one of those that when they're their birthday, they don't show up. But guess what? Dad, remember above. So Rachel, would you like to wear the hat? Okay, could we sing happy birthday to you too? Okay, we'll sing happy birthday to Rachel. Oh, look at all these smiling faces. You can't say no to them. Fold got a little crinkled right there. Anyone else? Is a hot commodity. No one else.
Pastor, he's not here. Gary, I know, has a birthday coming up this week. I think it's Tuesday. I know he's watching this morning. Could we sing happy birthday to him? He can't wear
sure.
The hat right now.
Well, yeah. But when you come back, Gary, you still go wear the hat. Okay? So let's sing happy birthday to Gary, because he is watching. Ready? Uh-oh, someone's talking. Where is he? I just saw him. Where's Chris? Did you just have a birthday last week?
Yeah.
He's smiling. Hey, Mr. Chris, can we at least sing happy birthday to you? Now, those you heard, relatives in the back, would you like Chris to wear the hat?
Wear the hat. Get out there.
You got a lot of family in this church that loves you.
Now you know I'm late.
Now you know I'm late. We love you. Okay, to Chris. Thank you for being a sport. Thank you very much. I got a wink, so that's pretty good. Then, what we do here at our church before we begin our service is we greet each other with Lord's peace. So if you would like to get up and move around and greet each other, we'll give you 3 minutes today. Because we got baptism and I got to preach, you know, it could get a little bit long. As we begin our service this morning, we begin with the song, as we do for our baptisms for our children. Father, welcome. It's on CD. Please rise.
Thank you.
you can be a witness too. Please be seated. We continue on with the ancient custom that the apostles started at the very beginning of the church, when households were baptized and children were baptized and brought in. And in Acts talks about the gift of the Holy Spirit, forgiveness of sins. So if you would, our service. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Our Lord commanded baptism, saying to his disciples in the last chapter of Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and then teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age. The holy apostles of the Lord have written the promises for you and your children. And baptism now saves you from Peter. We also learn from the word of God that we are all conceived and born sinful and are in need of forgiveness. We will be lost forever unless delivered from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. But the Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sin of the whole world, that whoever believes, trusts in him, shall not perish, but have eternal life." Larkin K., receive the sign of the cross, the Holy Cross, both upon your forehead and upon your heart, to mark you as redeemed by Christ the Crucified. Oh, you're a cutie, aren't you? So hear how our Lord Jesus Christ has opened up the kingdom of God to little children. People were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them. But the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter into it." So, it's your privilege as sponsors, godparents, to confess with the whole church the faith in our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in whose name this child is to be baptized. After this child has been baptized, you are at all times to remember her in your prayers and put her in mind in her baptism. And as much as you lies, give your counsel and aid, especially if she should lose her parents, that she be brought up in the true knowledge and the worship of God and be taught the Ten Commandments, the Creed, and the Lord's Prayer. And that as she grows in years, you place in her hands the Holy Scriptures. Bring her to the services of God's house and provide for her further instruction in a Christian faith. That she come to the sacrament of Christ's body and blood, and thus abiding in her baptismal grace and communion with the church, she may grow up to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of Jesus Christ. This then you intend gladly and willing to do, if so say yes, with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
God enable you to awe, to will, and to do this faithful and loving service, this work, and with his grace fulfill what we are unable to do. Because this child, Larkin, cannot answer for herself, we shall all together with sponsors and parents, as a family of faith, speak on her behalf in testimony of the forgiveness of sin and the birth of life of faith, which God our Father bestows in and through baptism. Do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways? If so, say, "I renounce them."
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth? If so, say, "I believe." Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried? He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. If so, say, "I believe."
I believe.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? The Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. If so, say, "I believe."
I believe.
Who brings this child to be baptized?
We do.
How is this child to be named?
Larkin K. Schreiber.
Okay, Mama. Larkin K. Schreiber. It's my privilege and honor to baptize you into our church in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth in water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthening you with his grace to life everlasting, and peace be with you. Amen. Dad? Nope. Lennox, would you like to hold that candle for your sister? No. I should have asked first. Okay. Receive this burning light. Live always by the light of Christ and be ever watchful for his coming. And you may meet him with joy and enter with him to the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which shall have no end. Lennox, go ahead and blow it out. Okay, give it to your daddy. Very good. Let's go to the altar for prayer. Go ahead right here and kneel. Yep. I'll take this. Let's give this a try. You ready? Wow. I had a little girl once too, but now she's 18. We pray. Almighty and merciful God and Father, we thank you and praise you that you have graciously preserved and enlarged your family and have granted Larkin the new birth. In holy baptism, made her a member of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and heir of your heavenly kingdom. We humbly implore you that as she has now become your child, you would keep her in her baptismal grace, that according to all your good pleasure, she may faithfully grow to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of your holy name. And finally, with all, your saints attain the promised inheritance in heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Through baptism, God has added Larkin to his own people and to our congregation of our Savior to declare the wonderful deeds of our Savior, who has called all of us out of darkness into his marvelous light.
We as the congregation of our Savior celebrate with you on this very special day and would like to present you with this candle. We encourage you to light this candle on the anniversary of this day in which Larkin became one of God's own. The candle represents the light of Christ which sustains Christians through each day.
Isn't she so good? Look at her. Do you remember? Okay. Please rise. Mama, here she is. Stay right here. Here's your certificate. The shell. I like to use my hands, but here's the shell. Lennox, here's her prayer book that you can pray with your sister. And here's the candle that you held. And then this is the little lamb that will go up on our cradle roll. And then when she turns 5 years old, you'll get this as a gift, okay? And then, from the ladies of their quilt, it has your name on it. And then, look at this. Now, Dad, you can figure out how to fold it up. And with that, welcome, and we'll continue with our service. And the children now are excused for our Sunday school. We continue now in our service with confession, and then later we'll continue with prayer. We confess our sins before God in the presence of one another. Forgive us, Lord. Our failure to witness to Jesus as the one and only Savior in whom there is life and salvation to all who believe. We confess to the Lord. Our misuse of the resources God has entrusted to us, and our failure to put first the kingdom of God in our words, action, lives. We confess to the Lord. The doubts and fears that paralyze us in the face of temptation and deprive us of the Easter joy God's means for us to know and live. We confess to the Lord. Our failure to keep God's commandments, our sins of thought, word, and deed, our failure to love God above all, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. We confess to the Lord. Forgive us, Lord, merciful Father. Give us pardon and peace, and free us from our sin for the sake of Christ our Savior. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given us his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. Therefore, it is my privilege to announce that all of our sins are indeed forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The greeting, the Lord be with you. The prayer of the day, we continue with by praying together as a family of faith. O Almighty Eternal God, now that you have assured us of the completion of our redemption through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus, give us the will to show forth in our lives what we profess with our lips. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. Our first reading is found in Acts chapter 3, beginning with the 11th verse. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in a portico called Solomon, astounded. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified this his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witness, and his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given this man his perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your rulers, but that God foretold by the mouth of the prophets that his Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all things about which God, by the mouth of his holy prophets, long ago." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading today is found in 1 John chapter 3, beginning with the first verse. "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord.
We rise for reading of the Holy Gospel. Today's gospel reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 24, beginning at the 36th verse. The gospel is brought out into the midst of his people. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled and why do doubt arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, and everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Please be seated as the choir will continue now with "Just a Closer Walk with Thee."
This morning, the pastor is going to be talking about how to enjoy the rest of our lives. To have a really happy and joyous rest of our lives, it needs to be with Jesus. So we're going to do "Just a Closer Walk with Jesus." This is an oldie, but a goodie, and the words are going to be up on the screen. So if you feel motivated, please feel free to sing along with us.
Jesus, keep me from all wrong.
Love, joy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There on pages 13 and 14 in your worship folder, you'll find an outline that you can use to follow along with the message and take notes if you wish. There's also an outline insert on the back table. My dear friends in Christ, my fellow redeemed, this morning we begin a new series, and the series is on the book of Philippians. Philippians is a personal letter, a practical letter. It's positive. It deals with the problems of life that we all face. The words joy, rejoice, and be glad are used 17 different times in this book. I'm calling this series Hakuna Matata. Anyone familiar with that phrase? Hakuna Matata. It's from Lion King. And it means no worries for the rest of your days. What a wonderful phrase. Ain't no passing craze. It's our problem-free philosophy. And I hope that after we're done going through the book of Philippians, hopefully we'll learn how to enjoy our life, no matter where we find our life or find ourselves in, no matter what life throws at us, how to be joyful in spite of our circumstance, our situation, our problem. And with that, we say, Hakuna Matata, say it with me, Hakuna Matata, no worries for the rest of your lives. As Paul begins this letter, He starts by talking about relationships. If our relationship at home is bad, life stinks. If our relationships are strained, life can be difficult. When we have problems with people, it can literally kill the joy in our lives, suck the life right out of us. Yes? So do we enjoy the people that we are around? The people that we rub elbows with? Co-workers? Person we're married to? Family members, teammates, classmates. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 9, these words. And this morning I want to invite all the men here and at home to read them with me this morning. You ready, guys? Husband, men, enjoy life with your wife whom you love. See, we are called to cherish them, adore them, and love them. And yet, as I go around to the beach, to Stern Parts, to Starving Artist, and wherever else I go around in Scottville and Ludington and surrounding areas, I listen. And I listen to people talk about their marriage. And as I listen, I find that many relationships are more a matter of endurance than enjoyment. There are far too many people that are married, the married folk that I listen to, that I run into, and it seems to me as if they're walking like they're constipated half the time. I mean, listen to people, how they talk about their church, about their job, about their neighbors, their family members, about their marriage. One more. It seems to me that we don't really enjoy people in our lives. We tolerate them. We put up with them. We endure them. What does it take to enjoy the people that is around us? Four keys. The first key, which was the hardest for me, because I was looking for a word, and I struggled. But I think I came upon a word that fits. We are learning to be grateful for the better in people. Paul is saying, I like to think the better about people. Focus on the good times that we have. Remember the positive experiences that we had over the years. What do we usually remember about people? The good experiences or the bad experiences? The last conversation, the last post, the good things they said about us or the not so good things that they said, the good things they did or the not so good they didn't do. And then it dawned on me, like with anything else, it's how we see them. It's how we see them as how we will look at them and view them. Yes? When Paul said, I thank God every time I remember you. I think, what is this? He says, I thank my God every time I remember you. But I remember from Acts, in Acts chapter 16, which gives us the background to this story, that he had not had a good time when he was in Philippi. As soon as he arrived, he was misunderstood, misjudged, mistreated. He was arrested illegally. He was put in prison. He was humiliated. He was whipped. And then he was told to leave town, to skedaddle, get, and don't come back. Paul did not have a good time at Philippi. He had a horrible time, a terrible time. And yet he says, when I think of you, I remember the better things that we had. Perhaps the conversion of Lydia. Perhaps the conversion of the Philippian jailer and his household that came to faith. I thank God every time I remember you. What? Serious? Paul could have dwelt on the negative like we like to do. He could have remembered the hurtful, the hateful, and the bad memories like we like to hang on to. He chose, though. And he made a concerted effort to focus on the things that he could be grateful for. What about us? Perhaps we've been hurt by a parent, a spouse, a family member, a close friend, a church member, a pastor, a teacher, a neighbor, by someone. And we're still holding on to it years later, carrying that hurt, perhaps that rejection, that, and you fill in the blank that you came with this morning. As a result, we don't like to be around them, to associate with them anymore. Even to the point of sharing the peace with them. We make sure that we go around somewhere else if we don't have to say the peace be with you. But yet we see ourselves as a good Christian. And we treat that somebody like that in the Lord's house. dare we? As much as he has forgiven us. See, we are to be grateful for the better in people is easier said than done. Am I right? But we are called to choose to see the better. Jesus says, love one another as I have loved you. Second key, pleasant memories are a choice. You see, we choose what we're going to remember about the past. We choose what we're going to dwell on. And we can choose to remember all the bad that was done to us, that was said about us, a past hurt, a past church experience, a past conversation, a past post, or remember the better we had with them. You see, it's our choice. Jesus on the cross said, Father, forgive them for being a bonehead, a meathead, a hater, a mean girl, for they know not what they are doing. And Jesus, he gave his life for us while we were yet a sinner. He died for us. He didn't say, Pastor Ken, get your life in order, get your act in order, then I will die for you. No, while we were yet sinners, he loved us all the time. And he says, Daddy, let's go. Let's do this. And the Father was satisfied with his son's sacrifice on our behalf. And he raised him from the dead. He is risen. He lives. Hallelujah. Lesson number one. We are empowered. Do we got lesson number one? Lesson number one, we are empowered to remember the best and forget the rest. Easier said than done. Now, I'm not saying that we are going to deny or overlook the hurt or what was said or to excuse what was done or said about us or to us. That is psychologically unhealthy. We, though, are enlightened to ask the Lord, the good Lord, to help us to focus on the better. What could be? And then I see in verse 5 that Paul appreciated loyalty, people's loyalty. Anyone appreciate people's loyalty? A friend's loyalty? Let's read it together. You have helped me from the very first day until now. My very first day that I came. And Mike and Joanne opened their home. And Mike is with the Lord. And Roger and Leela opened their home. And other people have opened up their lives to us and allowed us to walk in and enjoy time with each other. And I'm appreciative of that. Because sometimes a pastor and his congregation don't have that sense where we could let our hair down and joke with each other and have a good time, but yet keep it serious when it needs to be serious. So from my heart to all of you and at home, thank you from the very first day that I came, and then later my wife and my mom and my daughter came. Thank you for the help that you have given to us. So now, who's our Pumbaa? Who's our Pumbaa? You know who Pumbaa is? The warthog. Been loyal to us. Been there for us when we needed a friend or someone just to listen. Maybe they didn't have done anything spectacular, but time and time again, when we had an opportunity to walk, they stayed. They didn't walk. And when we're going through a crisis at home, perhaps a career change, when we were just being a jerk or being moody, they stayed. See, we are enlightened to appreciate that. If you and I want to enjoy others, we are reminded to focus on their strengths and not their weaknesses. And I know with some people it takes a lot of creativity. Just saying. I know it takes a lot of creativity to have a pastor like me always on the move, always on the grow, always looking how to reach and how to share the love and the care to others outside of our family. The third key, we are enlightened to practice positive praying. Verse 4. In all my prayers for all of you, see, in all, for all, I always pray with joy. If you're taking notes, circle the word joy. How would we like to have Paul praying for us? Would that be encouraging? Is it encouraging when we know that people are praying for us, remembering and thinking the better of us? I will not forget these last 8 weeks when some of you learn and then others you learn about Kennedy and how, say, Pastor, she's going to continue, we're going to pray. Four of my churches, people have been praying. People I ran into from high school and college and seminary. And you know what? That makes you feel good because you know you're not alone and that other people have been there too when their child had cancer, when their child. And it boosts you up sometimes when you need that boost. Right, Roy? You need that boost sometimes.
You need that boost all the time.
All the time. Amen? Okay, you want to keep preaching? Good job. Lesson number 2. The quickest way to change a relationship from bad to good is to start thanking God in prayer for people. This will do 2 things. First, it works on us. It changes our attitude about them. And then it changes them. See, positive praying is more powerful than positive thinking. I'll say it again. Well, say it with me. Positive praying is more powerful than positive thinking. People may resist our advice, spurn our appeals, reject our suggestions, and not listen to our help. But they are powerless against our prayers. Do you hear that? They are powerless against our prayers. Remember that, mom, dad, and grandparents. They're powerless against our prayers. Paul spells out specifically what he's been praying for in verses 9 through 11. I'll read and you can follow along. And this is my prayer, that your love, circle love, may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight so that you may be able to discern, circle the word discern. Discern what? What is best and pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. 4 things Paul prayed for, and we can pray these for people in our life. Pray that they will grow in love. 2, pray that they will make wise choices. 3, pray that they will do the right thing. And 4, pray that they will live for God's glory. That's a new one. Usually we pray We live for ourselves, myself. Here, the Lord wants us to live and give him glory, that the good works that we do will give him glory to those who see us. That's the new concept for some people. Not to live for moi, but to live for him. The fourth key, we are empowered to be patient. Okay, take that, cross that word out. No, I'm sorry. We are empowered to be patient with their progress. Paul looked at people's future and not just their past. He looked at their potential, what could be. And he was patient with their progress. Those of you who have teenagers, do you know what I'm talking about? College students. And then remember, we were there one day. Right? Remember the past? Just like me when I was your age. Oh. Verse 6. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on completion in the day of Jesus Christ. Christ Jesus. Paul says that what he starts, what the Lord starts, he finishes. Many of us tend to be great starters. Do you know a great starter? But they're not a very great finisher. You know, man, us human beings, we leave unfinished symphonies, unfinished books, unfinished buildings, unfinished products. Projects? Anyone have an unfinished project in their garage? In their home? From years ago? The Lord does not make a bird and give it a half a wing, Tom. He does not make an unfinished flower or a star. He puts the finishing touches on everything he does, and then he looks and he says, very good. Lesson 3, the Lord is not finished with people. He's not finished with us. To enjoy people, we must allow for growth, for development, which doesn't happen overnight. Paul could said, I'm not the man I used to be, thank God. But also thank God I'm not the man I'm going to be. See, I'm still growing. I'm still maturing. God is still working on me. And Paul enjoyed the Philippians because he chose to ignore the terrible, horrible, bad. The things that happened to him and concentrated on the better. If we demand perfection of people and our life in order to enjoy them, we're going to be miserable. Because you see, nobody's what? Perfect. If you're looking for a church and you're looking for a perfect pastor, you might want to leave. Because this is not a perfect pastor, this is not a perfect church, and these are not perfect people. We're sinners. We don't always do things well, but we know that God loves us all the time. If we want something to change our attitude, start praying for that person who irritates us at work, who irritates us at church, at home, child or spouse, that teammate, that classmate. But then be patient with their progress because life is a matter of growth. John 1:12. To them he gave them the power to become the children of God. The Christian life is a life journey. We're all becomers. We're all learning. We're all growing. We're all maturing in different ways and at different rates. But to enjoy people, we have to enjoy them now, not when they arrive. In verse 6, we have the word confident. Go ahead and circle that. Paul believed in God's power to change a human personality. Paul believed no person was hopeless. He never gave up on anyone. And this is a great promise of God. Paul is talking about faith, and faith expecting the best from other people. There's tremendous power in faith. We are shaped by expectations. We tend to live up to what other people expect of us. Other people tend to live up to what we expect of them. The common mistake is that we tend to judge people on a basis of how far they have to go, rather than how far they have come. And we are empowered to love people from the heart. I discovered that if people are on my heart, then they're not on my nerves. Have you found that to be true? Just saying. Heart love begins with understanding. Knowing why they feel the way they feel. Hear the hurt, the fear, the doubt, the trouble. Learn what makes people in our lives tick. And I'm not talking about the kind of tick that gets under our, or burrows under our skin. We cannot love someone we don't understand. Understanding them makes it easier. And some of your teachers might understand this, your educators. Some of the children that come to your classroom, they don't give the love and the assurance at home. They don't believe in themselves. They don't think they're capable. But you can be that light for them and let them know that all things are possible, that they are valued, that they are worthy, and they are loved. And you understand the home life that they come from. And then we can be a little softer to them. If we care, we'll be aware. If heart love begins with understanding, how do we get understanding? By asking questions and then listening. What comfort is it to know that someone fully understands us, that they get us, they know what makes us tick? And I'm not talking about the other tick. How do we love those people that even when they don't understand them, they are unlovable? Or how do we love those people that even when we don't understand them, they are lovable? God can testify how long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus in verse 8. Circle the word affection. We're almost done. In the Greek word, the word affection is a word for intestines. The King James translation uses the word bowels. See, in Greek society, the Greeks believed, they thought that the seat of emotions was in the stomach, the liver, the eternal organs. You see, we're talking about intensive love that makes us love the unlovely. This is not a natural kind of love. This is agape love. This is God's love. And that's why Paul said it wasn't from himself, but it was the affection of Christ Jesus. You see, human love can wear out, can dry out and die on the vine. The only love that lasts and lasts in spite of heartache and difficulty in tough circumstances is God's love, the affection of Jesus Christ in our heart. That's the only love that lasts a lifetime. In Romans 5:5, God has poured out his love into our hearts by means of the Holy Spirit, who is God's gift to us. The Lord poured out his Holy Spirit upon Larkin this morning. And now he dwells within her. And now it's up to us, as well as the parents and godparents, to teach her about this love and this joy that we have in the Lord. You see, Paul begins this great relationship, this great letter about joy. He starts off talking about relationships. People will rob us or can rob us of our joy unless we respond to them and learn from Jesus the way he did. And he looked around the cross and he saw all those people, most of them, except for three, that was against him. And he says, Father, forgive them. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. Please rise as we continue with Here in the Presence.
Oh,
Father, I know this phrase is not found in your scripture. It wasn't divinely inspired. But when we talk about Hakuna Matata, it's what you say to us as your children. It means no worries for the rest of your days, because your promise is that you will be with us to the very end of the age. You will be with us when we're in that muck and the mire, when we hear that word cancer or illness or disease, or we hear that we no longer need your service. And when we hear, and Lord, we come to you, we fill in that blank. And yet, Lord, you want us to enjoy our life in spite of our circumstance, our situation, our problem. And we know we can't do it on our own. And we know that we're not alone. But Lord, Holy Spirit, work in our hearts to have that joy here in this sanctuary, on this campus, that when people come, they may see us not as being perfect, but that know that we care and they're working to be a family that loves all the time, that there are ears willing to be listen and shoulders to hug. And so, Lord, we give to you the best that we have, that they may happen here at our Savior. And so that we may be blessed, the people in our community and the people we rub elbows with will know of your love. And the people of God said, amen. Amen. We continue now with the prayers of the church. We pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. For the church, abide with your pastors, teachers, and all Christians, that they may remain faithful and by your Spirit be a beacon in this lost and benighted world. Lord, in your mercy. For all missionaries, abide with them in their arduous work. Keep them from getting discouraged. Protect and defend them. And let a double measure of your Spirit rest upon them as they bring the gospel of salvation. And to the family of Talisma, to Dale and his wife, who are part of our church, to those who do not know you, Lord, in your mercy. For all parents, abide with them as they strive to raise their children in Christ-centered homes. And give us, them, patience, love, and perseverance, always putting them before them as an example of your Son, our Savior, who loved the little children. Lord, in your mercy. And for those enslaved to any addiction, abide with them and be a God of power, enabling them to look to you for the strength needed to break the bonds, the chains of the evil master. Lord, in your mercy. And for those who do not know you as their Savior, that your Holy Spirit would work faith in them and trust in them, and then abide in their hearts forever. Lord, in your mercy. And then, Lord, this morning, we raise to you those who are near and dear to our hearts and in our lives. We raise up to you the sick, the aged, the lonely, the dying, those who are struggling with illnesses and disease. We lift up to you Jim, Karen, Kathy, David, Lorraine, Betty, David, Gary, Carol, Ed, Lori, Shirley. Lord, as you know, the prayers are getting longer. But you know what? The prayer list is getting longer. But these prayers are needed, Lord. So hear our prayers for Ron and Tom and Jesse and Irina, for John, Joyce, Barb, and Harlan, Brianna, Macy, Joyce, Heidi, Judy, Richard, and Diana, Sarah, Tiffany, Julie, Gary, and Kay, Diane, Tim. Lord, those we name in our hearts right now and we picture them. Abide with them on their beds of pain and in their rooms of loneliness. Assure them of you that you will never leave nor forsake them, but will at the last bring them to your mansions and that unspeakable joy which we are certain because of the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. And if anyone else have a word of prayer, a petition, a prayer, thanksgiving, feel free to offer it now. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. And this morning we'll sing the Lord's Prayer with the choir. Sending prayer. Lord, lay some soul upon my heart and love that soul through me. And may I gladly do my part to win that soul for thee. And when I enter the heaven's gates and saints around me appear, I like to hear someone say to me, it was you who invited me here. Amen. The blessing for Easter. God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Christ Jesus, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. We, our Savior, commit in connecting people to Christ and keeping them connected. Together we reach up in worship. Together we reach out in mission. Together we reach around in fellowship. Together we reach beyond in love. Together we reach in to strengthen. The choir will close us now with Go Out and Serve Him.
Fill with the friendship. Thank you.